Hi there, my name is Scott Phillips. I'm the president and founder of StarFish Medical. Electrical engineering has really been at the core of what we do here for the last 20 years, and we're really proud of the team that we've assembled that can solve very interesting problems in electromagnetic compatibility and RF and high-speed digital and analog and FPGAs and miniaturization and flex circuits and also cost-effective design that I think have allowed us to really transcend to make products that are super successful in their categories.
So an interesting problem I experienced recently came up while designing a high voltage flyback converter. The converter required a snubbing circuit on the output to suppress any high voltage transients that the circuit might experience. The problem was that the voltages were so high that we had a very limited amount of components that we had to choose from. So what we decided to do was split the snubber into a series of several circuits. This lowered the voltage requirement for each of the individual components and gave us a much wider variety of parts to choose from.
Earlier this year, we had an issue. We had a customer where we were doing large amounts of data acquisition with an FPGA, but the amount of memory we had available and the amount of data we needed to capture was too much. So we actually re-engineered the solution to use an FPGA with a system on a chip and external memory. This enabled us to stream the data straight from the acquisition system into memory for the processor, and we actually can do pre-processing in both the FPGA, and then we were able to buffer and stream the memory as necessary, and it was actually a very large data acquisition that we processed up.
So an interesting problem we had here at work recently was we had a small low-power medical device that we needed to power a stepper motor with a very small battery. If we had driven the stepper motor directly from the battery, we would have browned out the device. In order to overcome this, we came up with this novel solution that used a small reservoir capacitor that we would charge slowly from the battery. Once enough energy was available in the capacitor, we then would move the stepper motor one step with all the energy available. We then repeated this process, charging and discharging the capacitor until the motor was moved to its final location.
Yeah, I remember one example shortly after I started here at StarFish. It was a Friday afternoon, and I got the dreaded call from the test house that our device suffered a ESD failure during compliance testing. We didn't have the equipment to be able to subject a device to 8 kilovolts, so we ran to the lab, grabbed a battery-powered electroluminescent driver, and attached a voltage multiplier network to the output of it to achieve 8 kilovolts. We then put the same network as seen on the output of a standard ESD tester. We zapped our test device here with the same 8 kilovolts, and it failed in the exact same way. We were able to apply a fix, make it so that it wouldn't fail in that way, and then Monday morning we were able to provide a fix to the test house and subsequently achieve compliance.
So on one occasion we were working on this medical device that relied on thermoelectric cooling for operation, and its battery requirements were overspecified to the point that it wasn't a viable product. So very quickly, and using freely available tools, we were able to put together a numerical thermal model and learn from it the actual requirements, and that resulted in a viable product.
The current device had an optical subassembly that was designed to align to the patient's pupils. This device turned out to be complicated and costly. So we replaced this with a novel electrical engineering design that used a common PCB and an array of LEDs. So this actually resulted in a device that was more reliable, easier to produce, and more cost-effective. Basically what we would do is energize a set of LEDs in that array to align with the patient's pupils, and this simulated the movement of the optical subassembly.
On a project we've been working on recently, during EMC testing, we had some noise and performance issues with the PCB. So I was tasked with taking that PCB, updating the layout. That was accomplished by keeping the sensitive analog traces away from the noisy digital traces and adding some additional shielding. When we went back to the EMC lab for more testing, the noise of the system was so low that we had to get the lab to recalibrate their equipment just to make sure it was working correctly.
Recently, I had to design an optical system involving a bunch of high-power emitters, a photosensor array. It had to have a removable fiber optic cable, And it needed to be insensitive to ambient light and also maximize signal to noise. In the end, I came up with what I think was a pretty cool solution, which had an aluminum backboard for the emitters and temperature sensors for thermal stabilization. It had a conventional board for the logic and the pulse control of the emitters, which was synchronized to the photodiode array. The whole assembly had machined in fiber optic connectors and also the optics for the photosensor array bolted to it. And it was all Peltier cooled onto the system chassis to keep the temperature stable.